Hi, my name's Mike Obland. I'm from NASA Langley Research Center, and I get to tell you today about sustainable ozone and aerosol measurements from a 6U CubeSat. I'll tell you a little bit about the project that we've been working on for a number of years called the Stratospheric Aerosol and Gas Experiment, SAGE-4 Pathfinder. Now, first, an introduction to SAGE measurements and ozone and aerosols. The Stratospheric Aerosol and Gas Experiment, SAGE-3 instrument, which is currently operating on the International Space Station, is continuing the legacy of stratospheric ozone and aerosol measurements. Now, why are aerosols and ozone important? Well, first of all, the Clean Air Act mandates that NASA monitors atmospheric ozone to monitor compliance for the Montreal Protocol that banned CFCs. So basically, the measurements are needed to understand if the ozone is recovering to pre-1980s levels, which is not expected until the late 2040s or 2050s. Similarly, aerosols and ozone are both used for climate change studies. So both of them are targeted observables under the National Academies of Science 2017 Decadal Survey, which is where NASA Earth Science takes a lot of its direction. So they're very important for ozone monitoring and climate change. So NASA Langley, or LARC, has been the center of expertise for ozone and stratospheric aerosol measurements for over four decades with the build, launch, and operation of several SAGE measurement instruments. SAGE-3 is the calibration standard for tying together the data sets from multiple satellites that are measuring ozone. So a number of satellites are making ozone measurements, but SAGE instruments are the calibration backbone for keeping this data record calibrated together. So SAGE-3 is currently operating and continues to be very successful through 3 years of operations, having been launched in 2017. But the question is, what comes next? All of the instruments that are currently measuring ozone from space and aerosols are getting older. So we asked, what's the next step that comes beyond SAGE-3? And SAGE-3 is shown on the right, top right picture during assembly before moving to the International Space Station, and the bottom right picture showing it actually installed. So over four decades of experience with this measurement have taught us how to optimize the measurement for the next generation system. The SAGE instruments use a measurement technique called solar occultation, where basically you use the sun as your light source, and the instrument measures the sunlight as it gets occluded by the atmosphere during sunrise and sunset. And basically, those photons that come back to you then from the sun having passed through the atmosphere tell you something about the constituents in the atmosphere, in our case, ozone and aerosols. So you get two measurements per orbit, one during sunrise, one during sunset. Now, all of the previous SAGE instruments have used a scanning spectrometer technique. So because of that, there's a requirement for pointing knowledge that's critical. So it requires heavy and expensive mechanisms to point the instrument. There's also assumptions that need to be made about both the mechanical stability. You need assumptions on the meteorological data that are required to compute atmospheric refraction, as well as you're making assumptions about the radiometric symmetry of the solar disk. Since you're only viewing a small portion of the sun, you have to make assumptions about the rest of it, and radiometric symmetry is not true, so you have to account for that. So what's another way to do it? Well, another way to do it is to actually image the entire solar disk and do solar imaging. So if you move to a solar imaging technique, absolute pointing is intrinsic to what you're doing. So you could just basically keep the sun in your field of view throughout the entire science event, which is about 6 minutes on average. Now, because the entire solar disk is in view, there are no assumptions required for the tracking mechanisms. You measure atmospheric refraction directly, and you measure anisotropy of the solar disk because you keep the sun in your field of view throughout the entire measurement. So solar imaging has a lot of advantages compared to a scanning spectrometer technique. And that's what we've used in SAGE-4. So SAGE-4 is a solar occultation imager capable of meeting or exceeding SAGE quality ozone and aerosol measurements. The great thing about it is once you take away all of that heavy and expensive pointing mechanism, we've been able to squeeze down the entire instrument into a 6U CubeSat form factor. That's shown on the right, top right picture. So squeezing it down into a 6U CubeSat allows for significant size and cost reductions relative to previous instruments, and that enables cost-effective sustainability of these measurements throughout the decades that they're required to be made. So basically, if we're going to be making these measurements for a long time, we need to figure out a sustainable way to continue doing it. And we think SAGE 4 is a solution to that. SAGE 4, just the architecture that we've come up with, also allows extensibility into other areas. Since the 6U CubeSat is much lower cost, now you can talk about doing constellations of these instruments for better ozone and aerosol coverage, better science. Just by changing out the detector and the optics, you could look at other constituents in the atmosphere with a different detector, such as water vapor, methane, carbon dioxide. You can also use the same architecture around other planets where it's important to know the constituents of those atmospheres, such as Venus or Mars. Now, the bottom table here, I'm showing the science measurement requirements that we're trying to meet with SAGE 4, and those are derived straight from previous requirements of earlier SAGE instruments. Now, a little bit about the instrument objectives and the requirements. SAGE 4 was originally funded in 2017 via the NASA Earth Science Technology Office's Instrument Incubator Project, IIP, for a 3-year technology development program. The objectives of that: we want to develop a laboratory SAGE 4 prototype that would then enable a follow-on to a flight mission. So we wanted to demonstrate the radiometric performance of the entire system through extensive laboratory testing, and then take the system outside, do direct sun look testing, and point it at the sun. The entire instrument is made of commercially available parts to the extent possible. Basically, everything in SAGE 4 for the ground instrument has a path to flight. There is no new technology that is needed to go to flight. It's just an engineering effort at this point. So we made a point of designing everything for flight right from the beginning. Characteristics and specifications of SAGE 4 are shown in the lower table there, and they're pretty typical for a 6U CubeSat. I'll point out the pointing accuracy requirement of about 3 arc minutes, which is easily attainable by a number of bus vendors currently on the market. Walking through the instrument a little bit, we'll start with the optical train, which is shown in the black box on the top right and bottom right pictures. The payload itself takes up about 4U of the 6U, and we've reserved 2U of the 6U for bus avionics. The optical layout was driven by a number of design factors. We want to keep the sun within the field of view, which led to a requirement of a field of view size of about a degree. The light that comes in through the aperture must be collimated to pass through our spectral bandpass filters. That's how we discriminate wavelengths for looking at the constituents of interest. The dynamic range of a solar occultation measurement is large. It's 4 to 5 orders of magnitude and requires excellent stray light mitigation. And all of the telescope performance parameters must be maintained through a dynamic thermal environment, because we go from looking at the sun and taking in all that light and all that energy to looking at deep space. And we have to maintain our requirements throughout that entire measurement process. The optical layout requirements were met by design from Cordis Engineering, company in San Diego. They built the telescope for us. The thermal performance was maintained by using low and matched CTE materials, including carbon fiber for the metering structure that's shown in black on the top right, and zero dura mirrors. Once we built up the entire optical layout, we took it to Space Dynamics Lab in Logan, Utah, and tested it for stray light, and it met or exceeded all of the requirements, including the encircled energy measurement exceeded requirements and was within predicted performance range. So the entire optical train performed better than we had predicted. It worked very nicely. Stepping inside the optical train, looking at the filter wheel highlighted in the yellow circles on the right, and the optical filters, the filter wheel itself is shown in the bottom middle picture. It has 9 locations for optical filters, allowing sampling of the specific wavelengths of interest, which are shown in the lower left-hand table. The filter wheel itself spins at a half hertz data collection rate. So this allows us to take measurements at all of our different wavelengths. but we also include filters and diffusers for doing calibration measurements. We have positions for doing pixel flat fielding calibration, so we can do a flat field calibration with every measurement. We also have one beam block position, which allows us to take a dark current measurement during every observation. So incorporating these characterization measurements into the filter wheel lets us do this characterization in real time as we're actually making the science measurement and reducing any adjustments or any assumptions that have to be made later. At the end of the optical train is the detector. There were strict requirements for the detector, which limited the availability of detectors that we could use. Primarily, that comes from the large signal-to-noise requirement in a shot noise-limited regime. That leads us to requiring a pixel well depth of about 5 million electrons, which is hard to find, but a number of companies can meet that commercially. The science wavelengths of interest for us are in the UV, mostly in the visible and in the near IR, which led us to a silicon-based detector. Now, the detector itself has to be kept temperature stable across the measurement, but we only need to cool it to about 10 C and keep it stable at that temperature. So we were able to do that with a thermoelectric cooler on the ground and within space. We'll be able to do that as well. The bottom pictures in the middle shows a drawing of the detector and the system to keep it stable with temperature. And the bottom right shows you a picture of the actual system, including the copper thermal strap, which takes the heat off of the detector. The avionics, firmware, and software are implemented in three subsystems. The camera controller captures the science images, the motor controller spins the filter wheel, the instrument controller controls the science payload. We targeted using a Smart Fusion 2 SoC from Microsemi specifically because that has a path to flight with the radiation-tolerant RTG4, also from Microsemi, which is what we're moving to now. We also use Cosmos software from Ball Aerospace for the ground support system control, which worked very nicely. When we went for instrument testing and the instrument was ready, we integrated all of it into what's called the surrogate chassis, which is the white box in the top right picture there. It's basically a little bit larger than a 6U to allow us some space to work in. We did extensive system testing and characterization in the laboratory in a clean room with a calibrated light source to simulate the sun. When that was done, we took the instrument outside, we integrated it with a telescope equatorial mount, and did sun look testing where we had it point at the sun. Our onboard software did closed loop control of the system to maintain the sun in the instrument field of view, which is the same way we expect to do it on orbit. The sun look testing successfully measured the ability of the instrument to take this measurement. And one example of that is shown in the bottom right. That's a picture of the sun on our detector that we did during sun look testing. So the instrument worked. Unfortunately, we only had about 2 days of sun look testing before we were interrupted by COVID-19 restrictions. And completion of those tests is pending access to NASA Langley, which is starting to open up now. So future plans, the team is currently finishing the final data analyses and the reporting requirements for closing out the IIP project with NASA, and that's dependent on finishing our testing at NASA Langley. We're finalizing details of the full spaceflight instrument design and looking for opportunities to get that instrument funded to send it to space and start construction. So we're pursuing a number of proposal opportunities now. We'll ideally be targeting an ISS-like orbit, about 500 kilometers altitude, mid-inclination, for comparison with SAGE-3 directly on ISS. So in summary, SAGE-4 is a pathfinder for affordable science continuity of ozone and aerosol measurements in the stratosphere. We need to make these measurements. SAGE-4 is a way to do it and continue the long legacy of SAGE measurements that have been happening for decades. In conclusion, I'd like to acknowledge the rest of the SAGE-4 team and thank them for their hard work and making this SAGE-4 concept a reality. We'd also like to thank our funding sources, NASA ESTO through the IIP project, the Langley Science Directorate, the SBIR office, and the NASA Science Mission Directorate. Thank you so much for listening today.